was wont to say, reports of my demise were greatly exaggerated. In truth, it has been about 6 weeks since we last did a video. I've been a busy fellow and having a lot of fun, but it's kind of strange stuff. Today, we have two Tesla batteries here with two controllers that are working, and we are kind of shipping those right now. I have a fella in California at Instrument Controls, longtime viewer and customer, who has volunteered that Americans can make this stuff and produce it. And so he is actually building these for us. We've shipped about five of them already and continue to work on the software and the hardware. And so I've got two Tesla batteries, a junction box, a charger, two inverters here, and another two there. And I'm just hooking up things in all directions and for all reasons and seasons. And I think you're gonna find some of this quite interesting. But first, a word from our sponsor. Actually, I'm the sponsor. You're the sponsor in purchasing this stuff. You kind of keep EVTV going from day to day and season to season. And whether it's Donald Trump, the economy, interest in alternate energy, or what, at a time when I'm low on manpower, our sales are going crazy. People are calling to buy stuff from all over the world. A lot of international sales, and we appreciate all that support, and we'll continue to develop, hopefully, products that will be useful to you in redeploying some of the technology of electric vehicles, continuing to develop new kinds of electric transportation. And we're getting into solar quite a bit. It's not really a sudden thing. I was reminded by a viewer this week of my October 2016 blog entry, E equals MC squared and the $226 billion man. And it kind of took me back to a year ago, and we were already starting to redirect a little bit to solar. I know this seems a little retro. Everybody believes solar's already happened. It is my belief we haven't quite started. We traditionally start with a rant and a rave about Elon Musk and what he's doing now and what he is doing next. And in all modesty, I'm very good at that. I've been doing it a long time. Those of you who followed me through a dozen years of Boardwatch magazine and the development of the internet, and now 8 or 9 years of EVTV and how that's developed, are quite familiar with why you watch and why I do it and why you want to know what we're doing. It's been a good ride. Elon, in November, Mr. Musk rolled out his semi-truck introduction. Actually, two trucks, a $150,000 day truck, about 300-mile range, and a $180,000 over-the-road Class 8 tractor. About 500 mile range and $180,000.
Now, at 80,000 pounds max gross vehicle weight, that's the most amount of weight you can carry on a U.S. highway, This is the real-time acceleration of a Tesla Semi. That, on the left, the thing that looks like it's not moving is a diesel truck. Even with 80,000 pounds pulling max gross, getting 60 miles an hour in 20 seconds. That's what it can do. Now, what about up a hill? Okay, the best diesel trucks can only do 45 miles an hour up a 5% grade. Tesla Semi can do 65 miles an hour up a 5% grade. Now, one of the biggest questions we've been asked about electric trucks is, well, how far can they go? Because, well, let's find out. So, 500 mile range. But what does a 500 mile range mean? And by the way, it's 500 miles at maximum weight at highway speed. So you're doing like 60 miles an hour. That's a worst case scenario. The Tesla Semi has a 0.36 drag coefficient. The way, well, this is a really good number. As by way of comparison, if a Bugatti Chiron, which is a $2 million supercar, has a 0.38 drag coefficient. So it's got a better drag coefficient than a supercar. We also have four independent motors. So there's a motor on each of the rear wheels and an independent front suspension, so it's incredibly comfortable to drive this truck. Because this truck has no gears, you're not constantly shifting gears. It has one gear, so it's smooth. It's like driving a Tesla. It's as though you're driving a Model S or Model X or Model 3. It's just big. It's super easy to drive, and it feels incredibly responsive. It's unlike any truck that you've ever driven. And the point of view that you have is also incredible. We put the driver in the center. So the driver's actually in the center of the truck. You're positioned like you're in a race car. You have complete visibility of the road and all the surroundings. It's a beautiful, spacious interior. You can stand up inside. It's got redundant screens. And it just feels incredible to drive this. It's one of the best feelings. It's incomparably better than any other truck on the road. You really have to drive it to understand just how good that feels. Like, I can drive this thing, and I have no idea how to drive a semi. As compared to charging a Tesla truck, you can charge at your origin or destination. So while you're unloading your cargo, you can charge. So the reason 400 miles is important is because you have to take a break eventually. So if you drive for 5 or 6 hours, that's about as much as you want to be driving continuously, because you have to stop for a bathroom break, get a bite to eat. In fact, you're legally required to stop for 30 minutes. So 400 miles is like six to seven hours of driving, which means what this means in practice is that by the time you're done with your break, the truck is ready to go. You will not be waiting for your truck to charge. And because of the Tesla mega chargers that we'll be installing worldwide, just like we've got superchargers installed worldwide, if you've seen the supercharger map, it started off with just a few chargers in California. Now we have superchargers throughout the world, and you'll be able to go anywhere with a Tesla consumer vehicle. The same will be true of the Tesla Semi. You'll be able to travel anywhere in the world on the Tesla Megacharger network. And that means we can guarantee the electricity rates, because these will be solar-powered megachargers that charge to a Tesla power pack. It's 24/7 guaranteed low electricity. And because these mega chargers are solar powered, your truck is running on sunlight. Okay. Every truck we sell will have enhanced autopilot as standard. Okay. That the truck will automatically brake. Yeah, you can read it too. It'll automatically brake, but it will actually automatically lane keep as well. So even if you're in the truck and you have a medical emergency, the truck will stay in lane and gradually come to a halt and put on the emergencies. If it doesn't hear a response from you, it will actually call emergency services and get an ambulance. It's going to take care of you. It's going to take care of other cars. It's going to take care of pedestrians. This is a massive increase in safety. Jackknifing is usually the worst nightmare of a trucker. How do you stop your vehicle from jackknifing if you're in difficult conditions? The truck will automatically stop jackknifing because it's got independent motors on each wheel, and it'll dynamically adjust the torque on each wheel so that jackknifing is impossible. Your worst nightmare is gone with this truck. Gone. Never have to worry about it. Reliability is incredibly important. We're putting massive attention into making this truck incredibly reliable. And that's why we are guaranteeing that this truck will not break down for 1,000,000 miles. We are guaranteeing it won't break down for 1,000,000 miles. Because it has 4 independent motors. You can lose 2 of those 4 motors and the truck will still keep going. In fact, even if you only have 2 of the 4 motors active, it'll still be a diesel truck. With an electric motor, you can turn the brakes into generators. So every time you brake, that kinetic energy of braking goes right straight back into the battery pack instead of wearing down a brake pad. So the brake pads basically last forever. You never need to replace brake pads ever. When you take everything into account, you take the lease cost, the insurance cost, maintenance, all of the factors, the fully accounted for true cost of trucking, a diesel truck will be 20% more expensive than a Tesla Semi per mile. All right, so that's the Tesla Semi. I hope you guys enjoyed what you saw. All right, guys, take it away. Thank you, thanks.
Why is this even important, and why do you care about trucks? They're a big part of our economy. Going back to September of this year, I did a off the series and long video, having no particular technical merit, about Tesla and their stock price. And predicted $950 share price for Tesla within 60 months. It's gone down since then, come back up since then, closed the week this week at about $343 a share. Those of you who bought in at 35 during my last, and I very rarely do these investment gigs, a lot of you drive Teslas on the proceeds today. So enough about that. About 24% of Tesla's share float is sold short right now. And that's very interesting in that Elon Musk has traditionally been very cruel to short sellers and somewhat merciless. He doesn't like them. And a lot of the early ones now live in their cars or under an overpass. It hasn't worked out very well for them, but the internet being what it is, I'm amazed at all the investment experts who in very condescending fashion explain how little they know about technology or technology investing and how an automotive company like Tesla can't possibly make it. In the first place, I've been following tech companies since, oh, the mid-80s, early 80s or mid-80s, 1980s. That was the previous century, by the way. Growth stocks, tech stocks, are a little different from other companies. They're somewhat flexible in operation, and you generally do not particularly like, you like profit, you don't like earnings. And there is kind of a difference. You want to make money on everything you do, and you want that to be pushed off to the next year, so you don't have to send any of it to the government. And that works out pretty well because you need vast sums of capital to invest in next year's growth. And all valuations of the stocks tend to be about where they will grow to in the future. And that's kind of based on what kind of stock it is. Technology stocks are the best. Automotive stocks are terrible growth stocks. And they're in some of the confusion. Tesla is a technology company who makes automobiles to demonstrate their technology. They're also going to make solar roofs and tiles and inverters and battery systems. And this month, this past month, they announced semi-trucks. Now, what's that? Well, the technology, once it's developed, is fairly easy to deploy. And when you can develop a product and have it on the market in 2 to 3 years based on your technology, it's almost a packaging issue. And indeed, that's what Tesla is doing. And the reason I give them so much valuation in the future based on growth is a blue sky. Blue sky is upside, but in technology, you tend to use it in terms of entree to large existing markets that you can become a player in fairly quickly by disrupting. And so the automotive market tends to be very difficult to disrupt. Tesla, with their automobile, has done a masterful job of it, actually displacing the luxury car market in the United States and largely around the world, putting Mercedes, BMW, and even Porsche pretty much in the shadow. And that's a big market, $85 billion a year in new automobile sales. Solar is even larger, potentially. It's all energy on the planet, so that's pretty blue of a blue sky. Trucking, what's that? Well, it's not only a very large market. They sell about 250,000 Class 8 trucks in the United States each year. They range from $130,000 to $175,000 each, about $44 billion. And worldwide, it's twice that. The 800-pound gorilla in the space is actually Daimler. And they wholly own a trucking company called, or truck manufacturer called Freightliner, who is the market leader here in the United States. And indeed, Daimler and Cummins are talking about electric trucks and introducing products, and they will have no more impact on Tesla's truck sales than the e-Golf does for VW against the Tesla. Some surprises in the announcement, and the largest one was range. We assumed that Mr. Musk was talking about a 200 or 250-mile truck hauling 80,000 pounds of freight around is an energy-intense business. Instead, he rolled right on this out on the stage talking about a 500-mile range. That's planting a pretty big stick in the sand. He did not actually announce a price until later. And again, I was surprised at the $180,000 price tag, which is at the top end, but in line with existing truck sales. And so they simply have entered by announcement into a completely new, completely different, completely separate $45 billion a year business. And I'm talking about that in a very U.S.-centric fashion. $90 billion worldwide. In fact, Daimler does $44 billion worldwide in truck sales. It's kind of a pregnant area for a couple of reasons. Right now, we are going through a badly reported, because of the total incompetence and ineptitude of our news media, there's a lot of things going on that you're just not being told because they don't really get it, know it, understand it, and are not able to present it with sufficient alarm and multiple heads of arguing people who have opinions, which is what our news has become. But we're undergoing a revolution right now, and one of the biggest players is Amazon.com. Would that I had just kept my initial investment in Amazon in 1996 at $8 a share. I would have as much money as Elon Musk today, probably. But the this company is simply taking over everything, and we're seeing chain stores and malls literally being mowed down to the point where now local grocery stores, Walmart, and other pretty much have to do shipping and free shipping in many cases to compete. Amazon is subsuming everything in its path, and the biggest beneficiary of that is, of course, UPS. But the online sale of goods has dramatically increased trucking, certainly here in the U.S. I would posit worldwide, and it's going to be an increasing part of our future. As for me personally, it makes no difference if my razor blades come from the grocery store, from Amazon.com, or from China. Who's got the best price? And in any event, I don't want to go pick it up. I want to go to the porch and get it. It will be in the porch, or they will deliver it here to work here. Trucking costs. I have seen a lot bandied about with great precision and great authority, and most of it appears to be bullshit. We look to the American Transportation Research Institute in Arlington, Virginia. They do an annual survey of actual trucking companies. And they do not think that trucking is $1.38 per mile. They, for 2015, count it as $1.59 to $1.60 per mile as the marginal cost of truck freight. And that's kind of broad and across the board. It does tend to be the majority of it interregion type stuff, not really coast to coast, but not local either. 100 to 500 mile deliveries. They count for 2015 fuel at 40.3 cents. Per mile as about 25% of the cost of 1 mile of transportation by truck. That's down dramatically. 2008, 2009, it was 64 cents. It went into the 50s. But the latest year, 2015, with historically very low fuel costs, it was 40.3 cents or 25%. The cost of the truck is about 14% or 23 cents per mile. and the repairs is another 10%, so 15.6 cents per mile for about 38, close to 39 cents, and 24% for the cost of the truck and maintenance and repairs and tires. The driver, of course, is the lion's share at 64 cents or 39%. And so that, when you count everything, runs up to $1.59, $1.60 per mile to deliver things across the country. That is a scenario ripe for disruption. Obviously, diesel fuel, which currently is not bad, $2.40, $2.50 a gallon, is a serious component of the cost, about a quarter of the cost. And we know from cars that we can cut that into about a third fairly easily. And so that offers some significant disruptive change to the trucking business. But out years, the driver at 39% is a significant cost. Believe it or not, right now, in this time where nobody can seem to get a job, and it's not that hard to become a truck driver, it's a hard life to be a truck driver, a lot of travel. But they make $40,000 to $45,000 a year their first year, $50,000 almost immediately thereafter. Owner-operators are up about $140,000 before their considerable expenses. And we have a shortage right now of 50,000 of them, and an aging workforce. About 5% of the truck driving labor force is between 20 and 24 years old. And so while there is a shortage of jobs at Fox News and NBC and in Hollywood, again, among the trades, plumbers, electricians, carpenters, bricklayers, and truck drivers, there's plenty of work if you want to work. Tesla maintains that they are not replacing the drivers with this entry, but there is no secret about their autonomous driving capabilities and aspirations in view of the future. And so between the driver and the fuel, there is a scenario here where they could easily cut the cost of trucking and delivery in half. And if they pursue that with any kind of success, it will be hugely disruptive to the trucking business, to truck sales, and to Tesla's benefit. Of course, the mystery with Tesla's truck introduction is, would anybody care? And so far, in the 1 month since they have introduced this, they have had 267 reservations for trucks. Initially, they were taking reservations at $5,000 per unit. It immediately went out of hand, and they started charging $20,000 a unit, and that hasn't seemed to slow things. The important thing here is that the trucking industry is a commercial industry. Nobody cares what the truck looks like. There's no impulse buy. There's no deep latent desire. It's kind of a dollars and cents thing. I think a couple of things drive an initial interest. One is you can get a little bit of publicity for your company by adopting an electric truck, and I think most companies recognize that. There's some green cred to be had in cutting emissions and costs and experimenting with electric drive. but the commercial world is driven in a kind of a bovine herd fashion. Nobody wants to be a first mover in any respect. Hello, shop cat. And you want to see somebody else, a larger competitor, make the first move before you do anything yourself. And so this is a little bit different type of thing to crack and market into. And Tesla's already won. They had lined up J.B. Hunt, which is one of the largest trucking companies, the oldest trucking companies in the United States, to take an undetermined number or unspecified number of units before their announcement. Walmart immediately signed up for 10 or so. They've since, as I said, reached a total of 267, but importantly, a significant number of them from Anheuser-Busch InBev, and now the most recent addition is 100 units from Pepsi Company. And they make my barbecue and jalapeno-flavored Fritos, which we have to keep coming by truck pretty regularly around here. And so with those names in hand, Anheuser-Busch, Pepsi, Walmart, J.B. Hunt, that, you know, the pyramid has already fallen. The ice has been broken. Large companies will spend money to acquire at least a few of these trucks to test and analyze. And so there is no perceived risk throughout the industry in doing so because the big guys are doing it. And so with less than a month into it, Tesla has already been opened, been welcomed with open arms by people in the trucking industry. There's a few things on YouTube with purported veteran truckers very condescendingly explaining why none of this will work and why Tesla doesn't know what they're doing. It mostly proves that anybody with a video camera can be on YouTube. Among people who buy trucks, it's over. Tesla can sell trucks. They will buy them. They will either perform or they won't perform, and there you go. Obviously, the allure is to buy a truck and to pay electricity prices for fuel to go forward is important. The performance of the truck that Mr. Musk is very enamored of, I don't think anybody cares. There was an interesting introduction of a supercharger that can charge this 500-mile truck in 30 minutes. Looked to me like what he was talking about was dual superchargers, like one on each side of the truck. I think this is problematic. I think this is a minefield for Tesla, and that's why they kind of glossed over it. People with Tesla cars do not want to be muscled out of their charging spaces by over-the-road rigs. Over-the-road rigs do not want to wait on some ass clown in a Model 3 to charge their truck. And so I suspect we're going to have a second charging network. Now, I'm not afraid of this. People act like this charging network, which so far has been the best thing Tesla's ever done, the biggest product differentiator, and for the least amount of money. Tesla still hasn't spent $350 million on a supercharger network worldwide. It's incredible. They're expensive in your and my terms. It's $1 million or so to put one down. Electricity is an expense, but in the realm of dollars required to introduce a new model car to the world, it's a trivial expense. As I've said many times, at any point, they could have financed it through the sale of Funyuns and Ho-Hos. They're only recently waking up to this, and largely as a way of engaging their client base while they charge. They still don't see it as a profit center, but if Tesla spent $1 billion on charging networks, I would not be the slightest bit alarmed, given the reticence of the other automat manufacturers and their willingness to basically concede the electric car market on Tesla rather than charge something. I would be putting a charge station on every corner, and it's for Tesla cars and Tesla trucks, and as a very proprietary type thing. He didn't mean it that way, but the on announcement, very generously offered to share his charging network and vision with other automobile manufacturers if they would help him pay for it. They demurred. I consider it a fiscal malfeasance on the part of the board of directors, General Motors, Volkswagen, and Ford Motor Company. These people should be removed from their positions for betraying the trust of their shareholders through incompetence, if not hubris. But I'm curious as to this relationship vis-a-vis trucking charging and car charging. I suspect that you will find that they're not compatible, that you won't be able to plug your car into a truck charger or your truck into a car charger. And I think he's going to need to do that to avoid chaos. After that, it's a function of time. The rest of the ramblings about Tesla, and keep in mind this 24% short sale is a double-edged sword, and it has no handle. The people that play with it can only get cut. They think that they can win. They can't, actually. They can only get cut. There is a limit on what you can make in selling stock, buying it back at a lower price, and keeping the difference. There is no limit to your losses on the upside. If Tesla goes to $500 a share, they actually have to come up with more margin or liquidate their shares. At the point of forced liquidation, it's at whatever price. So if the stock's going up and the shorts start to cave, it accelerates the volatility to the upside. And the run-up can just be horrendous. What is the true valuation of Tesla? Who knows? Who cares? It's a matter of perception of future growth and revenues. But along the way, it's going to be very volatile, and we're going to see some Bitcoin-like jumps as the shorts get slaughtered. Their mantra right now, and they just chant it, there is a online service called Seeking Alpha, which should be retitled Seeking Tesla Shorts. And these people go on for pages of what they don't know about technology and the automobile industry. Their main chant right now is that Tesla's going to run out of cash before they can deliver the Model 3, which is in arrears. I'm going to show you right now a little video clip we've run at least twice before, and for the same reason. Let's take a look at Adolf Hitler's Tesla. Ich komme bald auf Formation zu besprechen.
Im Süden hat der Gegner Zossen genommen und stößt auf Stahnsdorf vor. Der Feind operiert jetzt am nördlichen Stadtrand zwischen Frohnau und Pankow. Und im Osten ist der Feind bis zur Linie Lichtenberg-Marsdorf-Karlshorst gelangt.
Mit dem Angriff Steiners wird das alles in Ordnung kommen.
Mein Führer, Steiner konnte nicht genügend Kräfte für einen Angriff massieren. Der Angriff Steiner ist nicht erfolgt.
Es bleiben im Raum Keitel, Jodel, Krebs und Burgdorf. Das war ein Befehl! Der Angriff Steiners war ein Befehl! Wer sind Sie?
Dass Sie es wagen, Sie meinen Befehl zu widersetzen! So weit ist das also gekommen. Das Militär hat mich belogen!
Jeder hat mich belogen, sogar die SS! Die gesamte Generalität ist nichts weiter als ein Haufen niederträchtiger, treuloser Feiglinge!
Mein Führer, ich kann nicht zulassen, dass die Soldaten, die für Sie verbringen...
Ist das Feiglinge? Verräter, Versager!
Mein Führer, was Sie da sagen, ist ungeheuerlich!
Die Generalität ist das Geschmeiß des deutschen Volkes! Sie ist ohne Ehre! Sie nennen sich Generale, weil Sie Jahre auf Militärakademien zugebracht haben, nur um zu lernen, wie man Messer und Gabel hält!
Jahrelang hat das Militär meine Aktionen nur behindert. Es hat mich jeden nur erfüllten
Widerstand in den Weg gelegt. Ich hätte gut daran getan, von Jahren alle höheren Offiziere liquidieren zu lassen, wie Stalin.
Ich war nie auf einer Akademie. Und doch habe ich allein auf mich gestellt. Ganz Europa erobert. Verräter. Von allem Anfang an bin ich so verraten und betrogen worden. Es wurde ein ungeheurer Verrat geübt am deutschen Volke. Aber alle diese Verräter werden bezahlen. Mit ihrem eigenen Blut werden sie bezahlen. Sie werden saufen in ihrem eigenen Blut.
Bitte gerne. Jetzt beruhig dich doch.
Meine Befehle sind in den Wind gesprochen. Es ist unmöglich, unter diesen Umständen zu führen. Es ist aus. Der Krieg ist verloren. Aber wenn Sie, meine Herren, glauben, dass ich deswegen Berlin verlasse, irren Sie sich gewaltig. Eher jage ich mir eine Kugel durch den Kopf. Tun Sie, was Sie wollen.
That was first generated when we were waiting for the Tesla Roadster, the first Tesla electric car. When EVTV started in May of 2009 with our first episode, there were no electric cars that could be purchased for money worldwide. But there was one announced, and that was the Tesla. It simply wasn't available. They had announced them. They had delivered a couple, and then they were unobtainium for months or even a year. This was repeated with the Model S. It was repeated again with the Model X. And there's nothing different and nothing new and nothing alarming about the Model 3. I hold two reservations for the Model 3, entered on March 31st of 2016 during the first hour that you could do so online. And as a Model S owner, I get a little bit of vigorish in the waiting list because I own a Model S. All that said, Elon Musk has never met a date. Now, you can take that as a criticism and that I'm criticizing him for never having met a date. I'm not. He's a consummate serial entrepreneur and a brilliant guy. Now, let's say you have an organization of 33,000 people working for you, and you announce you're going to do a semi-truck, and you want to deliver it, oh, you know, when they get around to it, whatever they find comfortable. You want them to work at it diligently, do the best job they can. It needs to be a nearly perfect truck, and of course, you'll deliver it when these employees advise me that they're ready. What the hell? Nobody does anything that way. You'd never get a truck. You'd never get a Model 3. You'd never get a Tesla Roadster. By the way, there was only 2,400 Roadsters ever sold. I didn't buy one. I looked at them closely, but getting in and out of that Lotus was kind of awkward. So I got a Model S. But Elon Musk sets not impossible, but very aggressive targets and drives his team to believe in those target dates and to achieve them. And largely, you know, he does. He'll roll out the car pretty much on date. The Model 3 actually a little ahead of time, frankly. He accelerated the schedule he originally announced, rolled out the car, and did deliver some. Now, ramping up production where people can actually get one has been a problem with only the following models from Tesla: the Roadster, the Model S, the Model X, and now the Model 3. I'm going to go out on a limb here and say that they're going to have the same problem with the semi-truck. It's just a guess. The man sets an aggressive target, drives his team to achieve it, and accepts their best efforts with as much grace as he can. But that does not mean that the next time he tells them, okay, you know, I was wrong last time, so this time just take all the time you need. That's not how you move things forward as a leader of an organization. You need people to work hard, to work nights, to work weekends, to give it their very best, 100%, to achieve not an impossible, but an aggressive and achievable date, but an aggressive one. People are not going to care what kind of semi-truck you introduce in 2027. You need to be timely with these things. And so Elon Musk has a tendency to appear to miss his dates. Don't be alarmed. It's a way of managing technical development and innovation, and he's very good at it, and he's very successful at it. And I can't wait to get my Model 3, but I will, and I'll eventually get two of them, probably. Let's talk about inverters just a little bit. This over here is our big, massive, simple to operate 20 kilowatt charger from a company called Deming. I like their product. It's sort of retro. It's not really now, it's not really in, but it's a big old time big transformer device, and it had a lot to recommend it, mostly in its simplicity. However, technology does march on. I had some difficulty. We delivered a couple of these. We've had people coming in wanting stuff while we're still evaluating them, and we sold a couple of those chargers, and they're working just fine. I had a little bit of a bad experience with the little Chinese sales girl. She was just very snippy, not very accommodating, and it was a constant problem just with the logistics of getting heavy items shipped to people here in the U.S. and delivered on time and appropriately, and I fired them. Went back to Sandy, Guy King Electric Company. This was their 10-kilowatt inverter, and we had used it, and it worked. I've made some changes, mostly to the input voltages, to more appropriately accommodate our OEM battery voltages, primarily low voltage cutoffs and so forth. But they've made some changes in that this is also a 10-kilowatt inverter, but instead of this big case, this is now in a 19-inch rack mount, 11 inches high. It is still heavy, over 100 pounds, but you can stack these in a rack. Again, it's an off-grid inverter. They do have an option, and we're probably going to start ordering them in this way, where you have an AC bypass, you have grid input in the back, and set the grid to be the default, or the battery inverter to be the default. And it'll use whichever one until it fails, then it'll revert to the other one. But they have dramatically decreased the size footprint of a 10-kilowatt inverter to a 19-inch, standard 19-inch rack mount that you can bolt right in there. They have a display here that shows our DC input right now, 389.7 volts, AC out at 243 volts, 15 amps, and 60 hertz. We can very easily set the frequency and the output voltage. All of them we get here will be in the 240-volt AC split phase, L1, L2 in, that is phase A, B, and neutral, and separate earth, PE, ground, that is used in all American homes. Now, you can very easily wire that up and use it just for 120, if that's your what you need, but it provides the outputs for 240 volt AC, 60 hertz, and that's adjustable, and you can set the voltage at which it cuts off, because the current, the voltage is too low from the battery, and save your batteries, which our controller does anyway. But you can set this for a few volts under your cutoff on the thing and have a backup there. And of course, the upper voltage, not really as critical a thing. And it's pretty simple. Selfish solar is simple solar. And the big thing is it's 300 to 400 volts. No sooner did we start talking about the dimming 20-kilowatt inverter, and I had half a dozen people in with volt batteries and leaf batteries, which they were getting on eBay for $2,000-$3,000, and wanting a smaller, less expensive inverter. But all of the smaller, less expensive inverters, the 5-kilowatt inverters out there, work off 48 volts DC. This is what I ran into. And that's why we've had to go to China and sort of spec out just what we wanted, and of course commit to a number of units in order for them to do that for us. So we have a 10-kilowatt here, exactly the same form factor over there in a 5-kilowatt. The 5-kilowatt inverter running off of 300 to 400 volts DC, putting out 240 VAC, we can have to you for $2,995. Now, Magnum is running off 48 volts, is $2,300, and that's a 4.4 kilowatt unit. This 10 kilowatt unit I had doing while charging the Tesla Model S, by the way, 80 amps at 240 volts, 20 kilowatts. That's double. It's supposed to do 50% or 15 kilowatts for 30 seconds or so. This was doing 20 kilowatts for about 3 minutes. And it did fault out and quit at that point, but that's twice its rated power output. So it's strong, it's sturdy, and it was no problem to get it to restart, although it wasn't automatic. I had to switch off circuit breakers on the back and switch them back on, and you have to do that if you have a current overload. You're supposed to look see why you had a current overload. I already knew, but I still had to switch them on and off. Why is any of that important? The average American home uses 30 kilowatt hours a day, about 900 a month. My house uses 160 kilowatts a day. We light it like an airport. It's got three air conditioners. It's got four or five buildings, really, with a separate garage and distillery and another apartment across the driveway, a whole nother little cottage. It's got air conditioners and heaters, and I am an electricity hog, frankly. But even then, that average is 7 kilowatt hours an hour, is all the electricity I use. But if you have three air conditioners come on and a refrigerator come on, that could go to 12 or 15. But it's not going to do it but for 10 or 15 seconds. And that's called surge. That's because electric motors have a big dump of current during the first couple of turns. And once they get up to speed, it settles down. But it can be nearly twice as much current on startup as it is running. My big 1.5 ton air conditioning compressors, in actual operation, they're pretty efficient, maybe 3,000 watts. So on a hot day, if I got three of them going, I'm using 9 kilowatts, but I can use 18 to start them up if for some reason, and they shouldn't do this, all three of them started at the same time. So that's why you probably need a little less inverter than you think. I've sold this week a couple of 50 kilowatt inverters. Man, I love the idea, but who's going to need it? Well, one of them is a resort, and they may need another one. That's with multiple cottages and hotels and so forth. But for individuals, even as 5 kilowatt is probably overkill for a lot of applications. 10 is plenty, and we can get them up to 300 kilowatts from the same company with basically the same setup and the same configuration. So our 5 kilowatts, $29.95, our 10 is $39.95, and I just sold a 50 at like $16,000. These are very, very competitively priced inverters, much simpler than the stuff you will see online where they're trying to be all things to all people. But the one thing all those have in common is that they are primarily get grid tied, or if they're battery, they're 48 volts. And this is kind of a unique movement if we move to using electric vehicle battery packs. They're going to be in the 300 to 400 volt range, and so we're going to have to do this ourselves. I'm not making a lot on these. I don't need to. It's kind of like selling batteries for EVs. I never did like the business. I'm not really in the inverter business, but you're going to have them to use the batteries, and of course buy my controller, which is, you got to get with the whole selfish solar thing, and that involves inverters. If a few people want to use volt or leaf batteries at very low cost, and our $3,000 inverter for $6,000 or $7,000, you can have solar battery system that will power certainly any cabin, but even most homes. A 5 kilowatt inverter that'll do 7,500 watts. We happen to know it'll do more like 10K for, you know, a minute, is overkill. And this will let you use those Volt and Leaf batteries, Chevy Bolt with a B batteries, and so forth as we go forward. I think this is the way to do it. Everyone is petrified at 400 volts DC. If I've heard from one solar guy, I've heard from 100. Now, it doesn't bother them at all to put in grid-tied systems all day that have 400 to 600 volts coming off the photovoltaic panels, but a battery at 400 volts, they just can't picture it. I don't know what they think volts is. The guys in the solar industry trying to do this with 48 volt batteries, I can tell you it's a loser. You can kind of see why here. I'm using this habitually. I happen to have some 2-aught from each controller going into a junction box here that is simply two of our bus bars, so I can tile this together and switch between them easily. You won't need to do very much of that, or probably any of it. But the 2-aught is because I'm going to do some very specific experiments in hooking up an empty battery to a full battery and trying to blow my shop up. And so I need this. But at 400 volts, when this thing is putting out 40 amps of 240, I'm doing 22 amps. This is 600 volt house wiring. It's overkill. Don't tell me DC is different for any foreseeable distance you might be talking about to hook up a battery. It's not. You can use house wiring to hook these batteries up to these inverters, and of course house wiring to hook up the inverter to the thing. You cannot do that with a 48 volt battery. To do 5 kilowatts at 48 volts is 100 amps. We're used to 100 amps. We're used to 500 amps in an electric vehicle, not in a house. This is madness. There's a kind of a poetry and a rhythm to this. EV batteries are between 300 and 400 volts. Why would that be? It's because 240 volts VRMS AC voltage from the wall rectified is about 320 volts. So if you're going to build a switching power supply to charge your battery for your car, 300 to 400 volts is right in the wheelhouse. Now, if we take and we're going to make 240 volts AC, RMS, root mean squared, that waveform has to peak at about 320 volts. Bada boom, bada bang. If you take a 300 to 400 volt battery, that's pretty easy to do. If you take a 48 volt battery, you're pushing water uphill to do that at all. And so there's kind of a rhythm to all this. There's a reason EV batteries have morphed over time to be in this 300 to 400 volt range. EV chargers have done the same, and it's based on our 240 volts AC. In China, it's 240, it's still 220, 240 volts. It's one phase. In Europe, it's three phase, but still 220 volts. So it's all part of God's plan, guys. But in dealing with batteries, the 48 volt, the 24 volt, the 12 volt, the 36 volt, these are unnatural acts. They are the LGBTQ of electronics. Where you want to be is 300 to 400 volts. It doesn't hurt. I've been shocked many times. It does hurt, but it's not that bad. It's not any worse than the 240 volt AC. In fact, going back to Edison and the war between DC and AC, AC is simply penetrates the skin easier and causes more damage than DC does, because it's an alternating current at 60 hertz. The higher battery voltage allows you to use lighter weight cabling, because the what we call I squared R losses, the current and resistance, which is where the voltage, there's no loss in having a voltage. It's only a loss when you pass a current through a resistance. And so the size of the conductor determines the amount of resistance, and so heat losses by passing current. And so higher battery voltages will have less loss and less heat on smaller cables than will the larger ones. I want to talk a little bit about some graphs that I've found at from recent data at the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, a government agency that promotes the use of renewables as energy and collects some data that is of interest. And let's see, the first thing I want to put up here is the market share in California, California being our leading state for solar. This is the market share of various companies selling solar equipment into that market. And I'm going to put this up here. Residential inverter market in California from the California NEM database. This is as of 2017, and it includes data through the end of 2016. And in 2016, we found that 234 installations of in-phase energy, and that's about 10%. About the same 220 and those are each about a third, I would say, of the installed base are solar edge technologies. A smaller segment of ABB Power One, some SMA America, and the rest of it is sort of history. In-phase market share hit 26% in 2016. Solar edge market share hit 27%, and so 53% of all residential solar installations in California in 2016 was one of those two companies. Now let's talk about that a little bit. Enphase is a very interesting company, excellent company, by the way. They make a what they call term a microinverter, and that is for an AC coupled system on the roof at each panel. Each panel gets its own inverter, and so the panel appears to put out 240 volts AC at an amp. They're about 250-300 watt devices at 240 volts AC, and you simply link these up in parallel and to get higher current levels and bring them down and tie them into your grid. They do not work with battery systems. They have no DC coupling component. One of the advantages, you hear about maximum power point tracking. Well, each panel is independently inverted, so the other panels don't have any effect on how much power any particular panel puts out. And that's a very good thing. Now it adds a $250 cost to each panel, but it's been very popular. My point is, it's inherently grid-tied. You tie it into the grid, it has to have grid phase to sync to, or it puts out nothing. Solar Edge is actually what we have here at EVTV on our production side, a 24-25 kilowatt photovoltaic array of Rena solar panels. I think they're about 280 watt panels. And we have five Solar Edge inverters. I'm going to put up a shot of their online service, which our system reports to over the internet wirelessly. And so it monitors our output 24/7 and shows us what our system is doing. Again, each of these five inverters are grid-tied and they have to have grid waveform to produce. If the grid goes down, all five inverters go down too. They simply go away. They have nothing to sync to. And so, in the event of a power outage, having 25,000 watts of solar on the roof does me no good. ABB Power One is the same. SMA America can swing either way, battery backed up or grid tied, but by far the majority of their installations here in the U.S. are the SMA Sunny Boy, again a grid tied inverter. My point is this: over 90% of the solar installations in residences in the United States, not just California, but across the land, are much as ours here at EVTV. They are grid-tied systems. They rely on a 240-volt AC power input from the grid in order to synchronize their output in phase and voltage. And they do this quite deliberately. It's called anti-islanding, very much encouraged by the utility companies to prevent hurting utility company employees who are working on the lines in case the power goes down and you don't want someone with a solar-powered home powering that line and injuring a utility company employee. By the way, this has been very successful. There has never been in the history of the world that we can find a single utility company employee ever injured in the slightest by a photovoltaic array that was on and they thought it was off. Indeed, that was the case before any of this was done. It's a blue elephant gun, and I'm gonna guess that most utility company employees would check the lines for voltage before commencing work on them, and if they found some, find the source and shut it off, which is trivially easily to do with the switch on the meter. By the way, I not only think that would be a good idea for utility company employees, I think it would be good for any of you who are working on a system at home before you commence working on cables or wiring or whatever. Use a voltmeter and check it for voltage. So the bottom line is that almost entirely all the solar in the country, for various reasons, having to do with the grid itself. We don't have any battery backup. If the grid goes down, you lose power, and that you spent $50,000 or $60,000 or $70,000 on a solar system for your home doesn't help. If the grid's down for a week, you just don't have any electrical power for a week. And it's really, it would be kind of awkward to try to get any using your solar system the way most of them are installed. That's kind of a tragedy, and we intend to address it. The next graph is module spot price per watt. And as you can see from this graph, factory gate price for U.S. crystalline silicon modules, 2017. We start, let's see here, 2010 at about $1.80, and we're down to under 40 cents per watt for the modules themselves. Interesting graph. This is the cost of an installed residential PV system from NREL, 2009 to 2017, and it's residential. This is what you'll pay to put solar on your roof, but again, we're talking about grid-tied solar, not battery backup solar. And that started at about $7.24 per watt. A 10-kilowatt system would cost you about $72,400 in 2010, and that's down to $2.80 or $28,000 7 years later. And so this is a very good trend. I have to tell you that the module costs have gone down very sharply, and the inverter costs, I would call your attention, have gone down quite sharply. And your hardware costs, you know, your mounting hardware and stuff, really hasn't gone down much. But your install labor has gone down some. But your soft costs, sales tax, overhead, and net profit of the solar company have actually gone up. And what this means is that as the cost of the materials went down, including the labor, they're getting less expensive people to install them, and the modules and inverters, which have fallen sharply in price, they have kept a good percentage of that windfall and kept the prices up in total while expanding their profit margin. And why is this important to you? Basically, it means that doing it yourself, you can see in the crosshatch portion of this, over half of the cost of a residential install are P&I, sales tax, overhead, and net profit of the solar company. And so you can install a solar system in all respects identical, with identical hardware, with identical photovoltaic panels, inverters, wiring, and so forth, for less than half of the cost you will be quoted by reputable solar install firms. And of course, there's some fast traders out there who will, I had one guy give me a bid for $120,000 to put in a solar system here at EVTV. We eventually did it for $63,000 through a solar install company. To put in about $33,000 worth of stuff, but I wanted them to walk us through this whole process of an application with Ameren-UE for a rebate program of $2, which they pretty much did not do and had me and my electrician do instead. And so I should have just done it myself to begin with. But that $63,000 system, a company out of St. Louis bid $120,000. I said, why? You know, it's $33,000 worth of stuff. I can get it on eBay. I'm willing to pay to install it, but I would think it'd be like $10,000 or $15,000 to mount them on the roof and so forth. Maybe $5,000 worth of electrical work inside. Where do you get $120,000? He said, well, you know, a lot of people, well, you'd be surprised, they'll just pay it. He says, if you do go to buy that on eBay, he said, Jack, give me a call. We can get that for you cheaper than on eBay, and it'll help get our volume up. I'm like, did you just do what I think you did? Anyway, there's a lot of room to save money in solar if you're willing to do a lot of work yourself. The next graph is the annual deployment of photovoltaic or solar in broken into three groups. One is commercial, restaurants, factories, you know, commercial buildings, warehouses, and so forth. One is residential, which is mostly us, and one is utility scale. Now, I'm a little soft on this. It's like Apple Computer, Tesla, is that utility scale or is that commercial? But in either way, the utility scale photovoltaic is where most of the uptick in deployment of photovoltaics is going. Residential is up sharply. It doesn't look so on this graph because it's so dwarfed by the utility companies themselves. But it is up quite sharply. Commercial is kind of a linear function. As the price goes down, the installations go up, and there you have it. What's my point with this graph? If you're confused about whether solar is the future, vis-a-vis your position with the grid, understand what the grid's doing. They're investing in photovoltaics now. So whatever they say about solar, watch what they do about solar. That is the same graph. Same graph. I must have printed these out twice. Let's take a look at this, which I made from the NREL data. And this is data that you can get from their website. I've got it listed there on the graph at pvwatts.nrel.gov. You can enter your area, and it will give you your solar irradiance by date. Now, what this is the amount of solar that falls on your photovoltaic panels. We know that falling on the Earth is about 1,346 watts per square meter. And of course, that is filtered by the atmosphere and at ground level during most seasons. On a clear day, you'll see about 1,150 watts per square meter. We have kind of, by assumption, standardized for ease of calculation, not us, but the solar industry in general, on 1,000 watts per square meter. But I have seen us exceed that here. So it's really about 1150, but for government numbers, 1,000 watts per square meter. And so if you have a 20% efficient panel, you'll get about 200 watts of usable electricity per square meter. If you have a 15% efficient panel, you're only going to get about 150 watts per square meter. That 1,000 or 1,150 watts, you're going to see at solar noon plus or minus an hour. And of course, if you go another hour either direction, you're going to get less direct radiation from the sun on the panel, if you have the panel at exactly at the latitude. Of course, in the morning, you get less. And at dawn, you get very little. And at sunset, you get very little. But if you add up all the watts you get throughout the day, they will give you a figure of irradiance in kilowatt hours, the cumulative number of kilowatt hours of irradiance that falls on the panel in the course of a day. And this I have graphed here. You might note that in June, it's 6.51 kilowatt hours per day. And our average here is 4.53. And we can use this in sizing our solar systems. If you have a 1,000-watt array, it's going to put out in this area, just south of St. Louis, 4,530 watts on average in the course of a day. But I want you to be aware of the variation. Everyone knows it varies day to day in the weather and seasonally. But again, it's one of those things that is by degree. The problem is it varies a lot. And in June, our longest day of the year being typically June 21st or 22nd in this part of the world, is the summer solstice in the Northern Hemisphere. The shortest day of the year in the Northern Hemisphere occurs about December 21st or 22nd. And here you see a value of 2.2. So that 1,000-watt array is going to put out about 2,200 watts on a clear day in December on average, where it'll produce 6,510 watts in June. We're talking about the same day, no rain, no clouds, sunny all day. In June, you get 6,500 watts. In December, you get 2,200. I can relate this in the next graph. This is our 2017 grid tide production. On our solar edge system, we produce 26.65 megawatt hours during the course of the year. But again, you can see actually July being a little bit higher than June, probably as a weather function, probably had a little bit more rain in June than July. And of course, December is very short, but this was done about the 10th of December, so it doesn't include the whole month. You can see January is about 1 megawatt hour, and in June or July, about 3.35 or 3.4 megawatt hours. And so you can see the relationship between the Renewable Energy Laboratory radiance and our actual production track very closely, altered simply by the random patterns of summer showers and thunderstorms. But otherwise, being pretty much dead to the curve. And that curve is somewhat cruel to those of you developing a home power system with battery and backup. One Tesla battery is well able to power our shop for a couple, 3 days. However, our little 13 kilowatt array, which actually is shut off before the end of the day in June and July, because it's overfilled the battery, and we've had to disconnect from it. In December, it can't keep up. And that is a function of this irradiance curve across the year. And so you can see that sizing your photovoltaic array, during part of the year, you're going to be producing so much power that you cannot physically put it in your battery or use it. And then during another part of the year, it's not putting out enough to maintain your battery. And that's why we have advocated the use of the grid as a supplement for the dark days of winter and the periods when you have 3 or 4 days of snowstorm and so forth. And we can use an ordinary EV charger to do that, hooking it into the grid and hooking nothing else into the grid and simply turning on that charger when we want to do that. So we're going to talk about that and some other functions that I have added to our system that I do want to talk about next. Stay with us. Recall, if you will, during our last adventure that I burn up a TVS diode for your viewing pleasure, and that was a lot of fun. That is a little diode that kicks in at a voltage above what we're using to take out pulses caused by weather, but also inductive pulses from turning things on and off. And I had it on the wrong side of the contactors, and so when I would disconnect the contactors but connect the solar, I would get a jump to the solar voltage, the photovoltaic voltage, which wasn't loaded because the contactors were open, and so it burned up the TVS diode, having exceeded the trip point. And that's kind of a problem. So I was back and forth as to which place to put this diode. And it was like a $47 diode. And I had just burnt one up. I did a little further research and found out I'm not the only one with this problem. And there is a neat company called... what are they called? Delta. Delta Lightning Arresters, Inc. And they make a transient voltage suppression diode, but it's somewhat bigger. It can handle a lot more stuff. This is their model LA602DC. And this has a little screw-in thing and a nut that works on an electrical panel, and we happen to use an electrical panel to bring down our five DC lines from our 40 Panasonic HIT panels. We have five strings of eight panels, and they you know, can do about 550 volts open circuit. They maximum power point at about 460 or 480. We have a MPPT controller here. I'm not going to get into those too much, Because frankly, you don't need them. We tested this, and the way I burn up the TVS diode was not going through the MPPT thing and just connecting it directly to our controller, and so our batteries. But you get lightning and lightning storms and induced voltages and so forth, and the problem, of course, is your electronics in your home or your shop. We have laptop computers, cell phones that may be charging, all kinds of electronic devices here, and a single lightning hit or even nearby that induces a pulse can simply take them out. So you all use surge suppressors on your AC to plug in your computers and so forth. And we do too, somewhat. We're a little lax about it. This is the same thing, but kind of industrial scale, a big one that you screw in to the panel in one of the knockouts and hook it between your positive voltage, your return, and ground. And it simply shunts to ground any extreme pulses, and it operates very quickly. A TVS diode, its main function is speed. It drops in nanoseconds, millionths of a second, billionths of a second, actually. A microsecond would be a millionth of a second. A nanosecond is a billionth of a second. And so very quickly, if you exceed the voltage of your DC side, this will dump it to ground and save your precious electronics. And these are big enough where they can do it multiple times and in 100,000 joule range. And so it's good medicine for your photovoltaic panel. We have another one selected for 240 volts AC in the web store that you screw into the AC side. And by having one on the DC side and on the AC side, I think it pretty much accomplishes what I was trying to do with my little TVS diode. And they're like $69 a piece. And they screw right into the panel, and you wire them into the circuit breakers, and they just work. So somebody's already been through this, and I was busy trying to reinvent the wheel. Let's talk about some other stuff. This is a Andromeda Interfaces 7-inch touchscreen display. You're familiar with it. We have used them with the JevQ. And more recently, we use it as the control display for our Tesla drive unit kit. This one doesn't have our Tesla software on it. It has a special software that Andromeda Systems does for the Orion BMS. The Orion battery management system has been a popular BMS for EVs. It's done by Oort Systems over here in Illinois, I think. And they've sold a lot of those Orion systems. And so Andromeda Interfaces did a BMS display. It shows your highest cell voltage, your lowest cell voltage. You got a little picture of a dummy car battery here, which doesn't make much sense. Here is your pack voltage. Right now I'm at 390.7 volts. It's got state of charge at 92%. Now I can touch that, and it shows me I have 218 amp hours remaining. I can touch it again, and it goes back to 92%. And then I have my cell temperatures, max and min, 19 and 16 degrees centigrade, and I can touch those. And at 66.2 and 60.8. And that is what it is. This operates on CAN. We have gone to an RJ45 connector for our CAN port on our controller. And we simply have made a little cable here for the Andromeda. It takes 12 volts on two pins and ground on a pin. And then CAN high and CAN low. I have set pin 4 of the Ethernet as CAN high and 5 as low. Pin 1 we have connected to 12 volts. And pin 8 to ground, and so we can provide power to this plus CAN communications at 250 kbps, I think. And I plug that in, and we have incorporated into the code for the controller, and it sends this, whether you have one of these or not, out the CAN bus. Somewhat infrequently, and it's not a lot of messages, so we just send them all the time. And anytime you walk up and plug one of these things in, you'll get this display. Now, it doesn't show you every cell. It does have current on the bottom. It's sort of scaled for EVs, so not terribly useful, but it's separated into discharge current in this progress bar, charge current in this project bar. And so if you're discharging, creating power with your inverter, it will show it here. And if you're charging, it'll show it here. Again, like I say, it'll show you your voltage, your state of charge, high cell, high temp, low temp. And so a basic display of your battery without plugging in the USB. And we provide a ton of information now. On that, we've kept working on the software. We can tell you the serial number of your pack now. We can tell you how many miles it had on it when it was salvaged, or last time it was in a car and got an update from the master control unit in the car. And so effectively, the number of miles on your pack when it was wrecked. So the guy tells you the car only had 10,000 miles on it, and you can plug the controller in and hook up a USB, and it tells you, oh, it had 22,843 miles. Well, that's not 10,000. So you keep modest that way. Tells you what, you know, state of charge the the Tesla BMS reports, which may be different from what we calculate from the current and the voltage. And for various reasons, but we have ways to coordinate that. And so we've continued to work on the software, and I added a function for this display unit. This is an optional unit. We sell it, same price we sell it, you know, for the Orion BMS on the web store. It comes with a cable you have to make up to plug into the CAN. But that's it. You just plug it in, and your controller software already sends out the data this needs to read it. So it gives you a handy visual display. You can put this up in your solar room. It gives people something to look at. The USB, of course, is how you get detailed data. You can read every cell. Every temperature probe, sensor, set all your limits and so forth. And that's the way to access your controller. But, you know, the reason I don't put a lot of effort into making that prettier is because you're not going to use it much. You'll plug in and monitor everything for a few days, a week maybe, but after a while it's just the battery. You press the on off switch and it comes up, and you know, you may make changes to your system and want to change one of the values, cut off voltage or temperature or something like that, but for most of the time after the new is off of it, it just works. it's a way for you to set limits on your battery for its safe operation, and it will do it automatically, and you shouldn't have to do much with it. We have three little 18650 batteries in there, and you have to have that to start the system. Well, what if they go flat? Well, number one, they're not gonna go flat if you're using the battery. There's also a DC to DC converter in there that converts 360 volts to 12, and that's what really powers the system, but you have to bring it up. Well, what if those batteries go bad? Well, you can just reach in and change them, but we also have a 12-volt port here that you can just hook up an external battery to jumpstart it, and once it's started, you walk away and it works. And so that's the function there. But we've been busy. I have had a lot of people want me to get on my horse and get this Tesla battery done. You know, I want to do the Tesla battery charger. I do want to do it. There's a couple of complicating factors. Damian McGuire, who's been on our show many times, has been doing some work with the Tesla drive unit and the Tesla charger, and has his Derpanzer working, and he does this by replacing the inverter board in the Tesla drive unit with a open source board and software by Johann Hubner to drive it. I'm not only not opposed to this, we're probably going to have the boards made and offer them. It's not really the way I would do it, but I think a lot of you are going to want to play with that, and some of the inverters may have firmware that our system doesn't work with, and this may be a path to getting those inverters and drive units to work until we can get ours to work with them. I haven't actually encountered much of that, but it remains a theory. The open source board is a STEM32 processor. Tesla uses two very advanced Texas Instruments Piccolo processors that are simply much faster, much more capable processor. Uses two of them and a field programmable gate array. That's quite a bit of hardware. And they have quite a bit of software in there. And of course, it's field-oriented control, FOC, which is a much more efficient way of driving a three-phase output than the simple volt-hertz function that Mr. Hubner and Damian are using. I think it'll drive the car the way they're doing it, but I have to tell you that I'm very taken with my 1990 Volkswagen Doppelcabin. I bought that from Otmar Ebenhake, and we put a Tesla drive unit in it with a Quaif ATB, and it drives very nicely. I would like to take credit for all that, but mostly I'm just sending canned messages to put it in gear, advise it of the battery status, voltage and current. And the rest of it is a hardwired throttle into Tesla's inverter that then acknowledges that everything is well and goes into gear and goes where I tell it to. They've done a really good job of it. The Tesla Model S is a very smooth driving car, as I would expect it to be. What I didn't expect was when I took the drive unit and put it in a Doka, it's just as smooth. And so the art is in the firmware and the hardware in that inverter control board. And I want that. I We've done a lot of EVs. We do a lot of control. We have a GEVQ. We have inverters from Azure Dynamics and from UQM and from others. We know all about that, and ours drive fine, and we like them. But they don't drive like the Tesla does. They don't drive even close to the way the Tesla does. And so I like that. Debian is working on a similar function for the Tesla charger. Now, why am I more excited about that? A little secret, we can make the charger work now. Here's another little secret. It's ugly. Tesla requires a J1772 signal that is a true positive and negative 12 volts, not a positive 12 volts on the ground. They do have some functions for their fast charge single wire can. They have a high voltage interlock loop that has to be dealt with very similarly to what we had to do for the battery. They have some very peculiar connectors for AC power and for the DC power output. Connectors seem to be my life here at EVTV. So you have connectors. Then, I actually have to have a separate 5-volt supply to fake out this HVIL loop. There's some CAN stuff that has to be done to command it, to convince that it's in a car. And then it simply knows, it actually measures the water flow through it, coolant flow, and if you don't have coolant going through it, it won't work. Our Volt charger, for example, we use it for 20 or 30 minutes and shuts down when it gets hot. Tesla, if it doesn't have coolant, it's just not going to work. And so it's a 10 kilowatt charger. And we want to pursue that. Damien is replacing the control board in the charger with an open source Arduino Dewey, basically, board that he has devised for that, that then does CAN control of each of the three modules in there. This is a much better situation. Problem is, this week I think he blew up one of the modules and lost an eyebrow or something, so we're still waiting for him to get that done. That said, when he gets done, we're still going to have some issues. The Tesla charger is 12 by 18 inches, 4.5 inches thick. It weighs over 30 pounds, and we still have these very strange connectors to the DC side and to the AC input side. And so it's a 10 kilowatt charger. It kind of gets to be, what can you get them for? Now, we've gotten some very inexpensively and have a number of chargers here. However, it's already happening, and it's happened with the batteries. The batteries were, I bought one of these, I think, for $10,000, plus $800 shipping. And the guy wanted to sell me another one. I told him yes, and then I didn't hear from him in 2 weeks. Well, it turns out he got a better offer. He got a better offer because we're building controllers for him now. You can use them. A guy named Carl, actually, spells it K-A-R-O-L, Yipistripsky or something in New York, kind of invented the concept of taking the batteries apart and selling the modules. Well, if you get the battery for $10,000 or $12,000, and you take the modules out and sell them for $1,400 a piece, and there are 16 of them, that's $22,400. Well, that's 10 grand for an afternoon's work taking this apart and removing the modules. Well, that hasn't taken long to get out there. Michael Bream at EV West is now doing that. And he actually removes the BMS boards off of them. I need them with them on there, so he's no good to me. We don't want to trade in the batteries because everybody else is going to want to. Now, immediately what that's going to do is drive up the cost of the batteries to $18,000 or $20,000 and down the cost of the price of the modules to $900 or $1,000. And I already heard from a guy last week that's already accumulated 12 of these battery packs, does not want to sell me one because it's just too profitable for him to take them apart and sell them as modules. And I'm actually talking to him about putting them in the EVTV store. The problem is he doesn't have an outlet. eBay's kind of already full of people doing it. And so we'll probably put them in the EVTV store, but we're never going to see the batteries. You'll buy them from us. We'll give him the money. He'll ship them to you. The modules. So back to the charger. Almost inevitably, the same thing is going to happen here. The Tesla chargers I've seen for $1,200 or $1,400 on eBay already. At a bargain, at twice the price. However, as you've seen, there have been some advances we've had here with inverters from the Chinese. I'm pleased to report there are some advances on chargers as well. For a number of years, we used the Tai Ching Instrument Company chargers, the TCCH charger, which can be can-controlled. And many of you bought these as Elcon chargers with fixed charge curves on them. And if you wanted to change them, you had to send it in to Elcon and have it reprogrammed. We made some hay by making a controller to allow you to configure this charger yourself, and it would control it via CAN message. A very simple CAN protocol that TCCH came up with. And by the way, almost every Shinry does a charger in China, a couple other companies, and they've all adopted exactly the same CAN protocol. It's just a couple of messages. One you send to give it the voltage to charge to, and the current to use in the bulk phase. And then when it gets to that voltage, it automatically reduces the current and terminates. It also reports the actual voltage that it's reading and the current it's charging at along the way over CAN. They have a new generation charger, and we just got one in. I've ordered three or four more. We'll have them in the store almost immediately. This is it. And this little charger runs on 120 or 220, 240 volts AC. The one we're going to stock, they call it a 312 volt charger, but it'll do from about 110 volts up to over 400, and it's a 6.6 kilowatt charger. The interesting thing about this is that they've changed the design. They use automotive style connectors. This is actually about a 5 or 6 pin connector. You kind of pull back on it and it pulls off, and you line it up, push it in, and it kind of just clicks in. It's spring loaded like a air gun adapter. Let's see, it's 3, 6, 7 pins. We really use pin A and B. A is CAN low and B is high. And so I've got this hooked up to a CAN thing. You stick it on there, kind of twirl it around until it lines up, if it ever does. There it is. And just push it in until it clicks. So I kind of like that connector. As you know, I don't like connectors. It's a little bit hard to put together. Anyway, I put that onto an RJ45 with pin 4 and 5, and I can plug that into our controller. And we already have the code in the controller to control this charger. We've added three variables to the controller software. One is grid charge, and that's simply an integer. I use 20 with this one, and that's the number of amps to use in charging. And so I could just easily say 5 or 8 or 11. This will do about 18 amps at 375 volts. That's 6,500 watts. And so it's a powerhouse. It's small. It's 14 inches long, 9 inches wide, and 5 inches tall. It weighs 24 pounds. It is air cooled. There is no liquid cooling. I ran this thing for 30 minutes the other day. Number one, I can't hear the fans. They're 60 dB. Apparently I can't hear 60 dB because I could just barely detect that it was coming on. Second is after 30 minutes at full power, 6,500 watts, the heat sink, not the fans, but the heat sink, put my fingers directly on them, were barely detectable as warm. This thing is 98% efficient. It's just really a marvel, and it puts out 6.5 kilowatts. Now, a Tesla charger is 10 kilowatts. I'm gonna have this in the store for $1,000. They're brand new. It's 6.5 kilowatts. Collect them, trade them with your friends. We can get them in unlimited numbers at that price. It's very easy to control can. It's air cooled. You don't have to deal with liquid cooling. Certainly for a solar application, who wants to have a pump and all these hoses and a fill tank and all this just to run a grid-tied charger? This is air cooled. It's very industrial. It's like an anodized aluminum case, like any of the OEM equipment now. And in fact, they use this in the OEM cars in China, and China is going after EVs pretty strongly. And this is you know, kind of their most popular charger, much advanced from the earlier TCCH chargers. Smaller, lighter, quieter, cooler, and twice as powerful. We sold the zillion 3-kilowatt chargers from TCCH. This is 6.6. It's small, it's rugged. They claim an MTBF, or mean time between failure, of 150,000 hours. So I'm convinced we can hook this up to 240 volts AC and put out 18 amps into a 400 volt battery 24/7 for as long as you want to. It's $1,000. So my enthusiasm for a Tesla charger is somewhat dampened, certainly for the solar application, but even in a car build, that Tesla charger is the size of a briefcase. This is more the size of a lunchbox. It's 24 pounds. I can deal with a J1772 the way I'm accustomed to. No high voltage interlock loop, no cooling. It's less expensive than the Chevy Volt charger. It's twice the power. There's no liquid cooling. This thing basically, for my needs, I'm gonna say makes almost everything obsolete. We'll have this in the store. Now, with the battery pack controller, you don't need a separate controller. We'll have a separate controller for this if you want to put it in something else that'll work just like the Chevy Volt controller. But you're looking at $1,200, even with the controller. The Volt, I think we've got up there for $1,600 or $1,700. and that's the 3.3 kilowatt water-cooled unit. I was convinced that the OEM is the way to go, but this is basically the Chinese version of an OEM EV charger over there, and I gotta say, they've done a lot right with this one. It's very efficient, it runs very cool, it's very quiet, it's very small, it's very light, and it's very simple. And it's simple for us to implement CAN. So we have three variables in the charge in the battery controller. One is the number of amps you want to charge at. The other is a grid start. And grid start is simply a percentage, and it's your state of charge. So you say grid start equals 20. When your battery gets down to 20%, this charger comes on automatically. It will charge and use your cutoff voltage as its termination voltage, and it will charge until it gets to that voltage. You're never really going to quite terminate. Your charge enable won't go out because, which we're not using anyway, this is all CAN, because as it gets that voltage, it'll taper off the current. But you may not want to charge to full anyway. And so we have grid end, and that's another state of charge. And so with this function, you can start when the battery gets down to 20%, say, and end when it gets up to, let's say, 60%. And that's done by state of charge. Now, why would you want to do that? Well, we're not wanting to run our house off of this. We're wanting to augment our battery energy on those winter days. But we still get sun during the day. So what if we're using this at night to, because that's when our battery descended to 20%, and we start kicking this in and running our house with power coming out of this and into the battery, and we start charging the battery and it gets up to 60%. Well, now the sun comes up in the morning. We do get some solar power during the day. If we charge to 100% using this charger, what are we gonna do with the photovoltaic energy? So we're not really ever going to want to fill the battery with grid power. We simply want to keep it from running out. And so let's say we set grid start at 10 and grid end at 30. And so whenever we get down to 10% state of charge, our charger comes on. And whenever we get up to 30, it goes off. So it really only mines the bottom of the charge curve on the battery, and it does so somewhat automatically. We're going to implement that with the Tesla charger. When Damien gets his board done, we will do software in that board to make it look like a TCCH charger. But you are going to have the added complexity of liquid cooling and these weird connectors that Tesla wires into their junction box with to hook up to your AC and to your battery DC. And all that's doable. It'll be a 10 kilowatt charger. If Tesla chargers are going for $200, that's good. If they're going for $2,000, I just don't care. And so I think we can use this to keep the Tesla chargers from becoming overpriced because we have a low-cost option with this device. Either way, we're going to use the same TCCH CAN protocol and the same variables out of our battery controller. As you can see then, what we're doing here is moving the intelligence of a solar system out of the inverters and out of the MPPT charge controllers and into the battery. Now, if everyone would do that and make the battery have its own brains, you could take any battery and put it into a solar system, and it would command the inverters and the chargers and so forth to do whatever you want it to do. But that's not what they're doing. They're putting the brains in the inverters and also in the charge controllers in conflict with each other. Some of them are, you know, like Schneider's tying it together. They had a ZAN bus. I inquired about that, and they said, well, they're going to a new communications protocol. I said, great, send it to me. We'll make our stuff work with it. And they said, well, we'll take a look at that. These people are yesterday's news. This is going to move past them. And their corporate hubris is going to get them. I do not believe ultimately that people are going to accept spending $20,000, $30,000, $60,000, $70,000, $80,000 on solar for their homes, only to be told if the grid goes down, you're out. I believe the future has to do with battery energy storage for solar. Elon Musk is working that at the utility grid scale, and I'm working it at the garage scale for the rest of us. Let's take EV batteries and do them. And by the way, I get inquiries every day from people that basically want to take what I'm doing and do it themselves and beat me at this game somehow if I'll just help them. Again, there is a lot of room in the pool. There are a lot of 24, now 30 kilowatt leaf batteries out there that can be used for this purpose. And there's even some volt batteries out there that are now up to close to 20 kilowatt hours and going for cheap. You can put two of them together. They have battery management systems. The nature of these batteries, as I have said, and Yehu doesn't get it, but there's a lot he doesn't. LiFePO4 cells are one thing, and these NCA and NCM cells are a different. And you do need to use the BMS. Fortunately, Michael Breen sent me a box of BMS boards off of modules that he's not using. He takes them off and sells them some sort of di-lithium crystal BMS that he and Thunderstruck have worked out there in California. Good luck with that. I hope there are no fires. But I bought all those BMS boards, and so I should be able to get our BMS, the module controller, working with my Renault battery in the Doka, using the Tesla module boards to hook into it. So thank you, Michael. Getting to be a thing too. We have not ceased working on the module level, and we're going to continue that and in fact deploy a battery for the Tescalade at some point. But we've got a lot of software work to do and a lot of hardware work to do, both at the pack level and at the module level. I'm getting old. I have to have a nap every afternoon. I dribble a little bit. I have to have my blankie and my Dr. Pepper. And so I'm not going to be as productive with videos and blogs as I have been. For criminy's sake, there's 320 videos up there. If you miss me, check the reruns. You can play them again. We will continue and will continue to produce videos. Perhaps not the pace you like. I have to tell you that the internet has developed in ways I just really had hoped it would not when we embarked on this in 1987 at Boardwatch Magazine. the number of people that get on and comment sagely on my videos and so forth, on YouTube particularly. And it's astounding. It's not that I disagree with them, and it's not that they're lacking in information. At this point, I am alarmed and offended, not at their opinions or at their take on this, but that they exist on the planet at all. It is just criminal that these people share breath with you and I on the same planet. They're just atrocious. And where they get some of this information and point of view, I just can't imagine. But they want to be heard. I had a guy want to discuss the restaurant business with me because of some comments I made about a dear friend who runs a restaurant here. I have owned a restaurant, and he has worked in one. And so he was going to explain to me how they work. It's not that I disagree or that we have different information. It's that I'm alarmed he exists and I'm offended by it. And that interaction with the public I've been doing for 9 years with EVTV, and I'm about worn out. I just have always suffered fools poorly, and at this age and state, I don't want to suffer them at all. I'm alarmed that they exist. But not enough to do anything about it. So that's where we're at this evening, Saturday evening, December 16th. We have new inverters and at lower cost, a new charger and at lower cost, and we have implemented both the charger and our longtime friend Andromeda Interfaces device for use with our controller. As you can see, we've got two prototypes here. One is in a kind of a large plastic box. We use some Deutsch connectors. The other is with a smaller metal box with dust covers for the can and the USB. And we've gone to a little bit different connector. This is a aviation style from when I was 20 years old. Military type. It's got a little bakelite thing, two pins, and it's slotted, and you stick it in and screw it on. An aviation style mill type connector. Not precisely an Amphenol. These are cheap Chinese UXLs, Uxels, I guess. But they seem to work admirably for the little bit of 12 volt. This is my 12 volt input for this one. And then we have the same thing for the output. I used a diode to isolate our two charge enable signals from each of these controllers to the solar contactor that applies our solar voltage to the batteries. I had an incident where one of them turned on the charge enable and it backfed to the other controller and turned it on. This is a junction box where I have both batteries tied together, tied to the charger, tied to the inverter, and lets me hook everything up together. But I didn't really mean for it to all be hooked up together and the two batteries to be hooked together. Interestingly, one battery was at 85% charge, and one battery was at about 93%, and that was about 393 volts, and I'd say 385, and we reached a peak, and our software can now detect current peaks. In fact, I've added a function where you can limit current, where, let's say, you enter 300 amps. If it hits 300 amps, it's going to disconnect the battery. So kind of like a fuse, an internal fuse, if you hit a certain current level, it will simply kick out. You can make that 800 amps or 300 amps, whatever you want. But there's a reason for all this and why I have two batteries here. I actually want to test the current levels between a 90% state of charge battery and an 80% state of charge battery. I just intended to do it when I wanted to, not because of a back feed through the charge enable port. We're going to pursue that and do a 90% to a 70%, and a 90% to a 60%, and a 90% to a 50%. And we're going to keep doing that and map the curve of how much initial current surge you get when you hook one Tesla 85 kilowatt battery to the other. Now, there's ways to calculate this, but they don't mean much if it's different when you actually hook them up. As Yogi Berra said, the difference in theory, there is no difference between theory and practice. But in practice, there is. And so we want to see what actually happens when you hook up a half-full battery to a full battery, and a half-full battery to an empty battery, and so forth, to see what kind of current levels we get. Why would that be important? Tesla has, from the beginning of the Model S, had a CHAdeMO adapter. And we have a CHAdeMO charger that we can use and tie it right into this box and charge the Tesla Model S from these batteries right now. And that's great. We actually have some expertise with CHAdeMO. We developed a little controller. Pablo did the hardware. Colin and I did the software, and neither one of us had a CHAdeMO to test with. And so Damien in Ireland had a car, and they had CHAdeMO chargers there. And so with a guy in Portugal, a guy in Michigan, one in Cape Girardeau, and one in Ireland, we kind of got CHAdeMO working. It was a sort of an awkward long-distance thing, and it led to some lessons hard learned. And one of them was that the guys building the CHAdeMO charge EVSE were not following the specification. The specification is very clear. It does not offer any options. You can charge at a CHAdeMO station from 50 to 500 volt batteries. That's the spec. If you tell people that you are a CHAdeMO charge station, you have to be able to do that. Well, unless you don't want to, apparently, because we got it working with the kind of the 800-pound gorilla of CHAdeMO charge stations. But when we went to some other off brands, it wouldn't work. And what it turned out to be, and I mean, we tested this over and over and over again, did software changes over and over and over again. I actually wrote a program that doesn't do CHAdeMO, it just prints CHAdeMO out in English as it occurs real time. And you can capture this to a log and see what every bit of every byte of the CHAdeMO exchange is doing. So we can line that up against the actual CAN traffic and easily tell where this thing went awry. As it turns out, these chargers simply would not charge below 250 volts. And we actually asked some of them about it, and they said, well, there's no cars that are below 250 volts. Well, yeah, there was a motorcycle guy that built Chatamo into his motorcycle and sold them and had 15 or 20 of them out there, and then found out that at some charge stations it simply wouldn't charge his motorcycle because it was like 125-volt system. And so this is what happens when you have ass clowns trying to market equipment to be to a spec, and they don't feel that they should honor the specification because their main market really doesn't use that voltage. That's not how you write a specification, and it's not how you design equipment to it. Rant off, we know quite a bit about Chatamo, and the Tesla will respond to Chatamo, and what it does is close to contactors, bypassing the internal chargers and connecting the battery directly to the charge port, where the Chatamo charger then provides current voltage to the car. That kind of gives us access to the battery directly. Now, what Tesla's software is going to do when we start taking power out of the battery instead of putting it in, I'm not too sure. But it's kind of interesting that we would have access to the battery and could connect it directly to this. If all that works out, and it would be a long shot that they would not, when they're asking for 50 amps of charge and we're taking 40 amps from them, it would be unusual for them not to do something about it. But then on the other hand, why would they? You expect the Chatamo charger to do what you're telling it to. And so there's a possibility that we could hook a Tesla battery up to our solar system and either charge the car directly, that will probably work, without the Chatamo charger. Simply manage the CAN traffic and the relays and hook it up to our battery system here, our solar panels basically directly charging into the car. The battery here being a buffer in some ways, but essentially supercharging in your own garage. You can bring your car in. Now, it's not going to fully charge your car. This battery will go down, the car battery will come up, and it'll reach some equilibrium. And at that point, it's going to slow down to whatever your photovoltaic array is putting out will go into all the batteries together, both your home battery and your vehicle battery. But you can supercharge up to a point at home. But you can also take energy out of your car and supplement your home system. If your house and area is out of electricity and your battery gets low, in theory, you can take your Tesla somewhere else to a supercharger, charge it up, bring it home, and dump it into the battery. So the point is not any particular scenario, but to be able to integrate your Tesla Model S vehicle with your home Tesla Model S battery and your solar system. And so that's where we're going. I want to find out what the limits are in doing that kind of bad boy directly. We can certainly use our $20,000 Chatamo 50 kilowatt charge station to charge the car off this, and we'll demonstrate that shortly. I can see taking a Tesla wall charger, gutting it, putting in one of our little controller boards, and hooking it to our solar system, and you just plug your Tesla in, and basically it becomes one with your home battery system. But not if we're going to surge the current. Charging at 125 amps, CHAdeMO, the Tesla superchargers, a little higher than that. The battery can certainly do 300 amps. The charge port, I'm going to guess, is probably good for 300 amps. Beyond that, I don't want to play. You don't want to mess up your car wiring to do this. But the other thing about I squared R losses is they're sort of time sensitive. Heat builds up. If you surge to 300 amps, but it very quickly goes to 100, and then to 80. That's okay. I live with that. So we're going to play back and forth between these two batteries in a controlled fashion and find out what the current limitations are in connecting batteries up to each other at a 400-volt, 75-kilowatt scale. On that note, I would say that we've also decoded. Tesla has a canned messages that tell you how much energy is in the battery in kilowatts and how much energy you need to fill it, and their calculation is state of charge. I know they've told you these are 85 kilowatt batteries, but both of them tell me that they have 50K in them and they need 25K to be full. And when they get to 70K in them, they need 5K. And when they get down to having 10K, they need 65K. Tesla's battery management system engineers think this is a 75 kilowatt battery. And you do have to charge it up to the full 4.2 volts in order to get it to say 100%. And that's at 75K. So their 85 kilowatts is kind of marketing speak. The disparity may have to do with voltage. We've had this confusion at EVTV and noted it pretty much across the land. When you say a 75 kilowatt battery, that is the average voltage on a typical discharge curve from full to empty, and we variously refer to that average voltage in a Tesla pack as 3.6 or 3.7 volts. They're a little bit vague about that. Now, if you take 4.2 volts and multiply it times the amp hour capacity, 220 or 230 amp hours, you may well come up with 85 kilowatt hours. But if you take the average voltage, it's more like 75. And that may be the source of the confusion. The proper way to measure the energy out is, of course, the average voltage during a discharge curve times the true amp hour capacity of the pack. We've always been a little bit focused on ampere hours. That fails to take into effect the accelerating nature of the amp hour discharge. As voltage comes down, the current has to go up to put out the same power. But it's more of a true measure of the energy in the battery. Kilowatt hours is perhaps factors out that accelerating nature. But it's a little bit one-off. And so these are terms and calculations used in the industry and variously abused. Hopefully that clears up what we're talking about there. If you take a 100 amp hour battery and